We're going to take a quick pause to let our Fox News stations join us after just a moment. We are back. This is the Fox News Channel's continuing coverage of the terrorist attacks today in New York and Washington, D.C. Four airliners hijacked, three hit targets in New York and Washington, the Twin Towers of the World Trade Center, as well as the Pentagon. Untold number of people have been killed. We have no idea how many. We know there's something upwards of 50,000 in the World Trade Center towers. This is a picture of the second plane hitting the second tower this morning, right about 9 o'clock. That plane was loaded with passengers, hijacked, and flown directly into those towers. And the incredible devastation that has followed. Monsignor Jim Lisante of the Catholic Church is with us right now. Linda?
We also have some more information to bring in, perhaps a very bitter coincidence. It so happens that September 11th was declared an international day of peace by the United Nations. Today that we're obviously seeing that that the declaration of that date is so very, very sad. Also getting information about some of the victims who were aboard those planes. There were four of them hijacked and crashed. Two American Airlines, two United Airlines. They're beginning to release more and more of the passenger manifest. What is perhaps most important right now is that intelligence sources are telling us they believe that on one of those hijacked flights, there was a person who was connected with Osama bin Laden, and that that person may have some connection in Broward County, Florida, or Daytona Beach, Florida, and that the FBI may be preparing to launch some sort of search in those areas. We're also getting word of other people who were on board those flights. We have mentioned before that Barbara Olson, a colleague here at Fox News, a frequent political commentator, was on board the plane that took off from Dulles Airport and ended up crashing into the Pentagon. Word now coming in that the passengers were herded in the back of the plane and told to call their loved ones and let them know that that plane was going down and that they were going to die. Also, more information coming in about others who were on board. The American Airlines Flight 11 from Boston to Los Angeles. Among others, we now know that the executive producer of the NBC TV show Frasier was on board that plane, along with his wife. Also, the co-founder of a very well-known technology company called Akamai, also on board American Airlines Flight 11 from Boston. More and more names coming in, but we are getting more and more information from those manifests. They are not complete yet. American Airlines, United Airlines, trying to reach all the relatives of those on board those planes, and until they do so, they will not give us a complete list of the manifests. John.
Before we go back to Monsignor Lisante, let's go to our Dari Alexander, who is at Saint Vincents, where they've been handling the wounded and the burned and the maimed and all of those injured today. Dari has some new information about what is going on there now. Dari?
Yeah, actually, John, over my shoulder, you can see they're actually bringing out a police officer, New York City police officer. There you see him on a gurney. I'm understanding that they are actually going to start digging again down at the World Trade Center. So they're expecting in the next couple of hours for things to get very, very busy here at St. Vincent's. Apparently, there's been a bit of a lull. You see another officer on a gurney. This officer actually laying down, and he does not look to be conscious. There are several emergency workers around him, and I guess they're going to be lifting him off very, very carefully here. This is actually a bit more than we've seen in the last few moments. They just picked him up. He appears not to be moving at all. Like I said, this is a bit more action that we've seen in the last half an hour. We understand when they begin digging, and we saw lots of heavy construction equipment heading south towards the World Trade Center. Apparently, they're expecting to have a lot more, many more people arriving at the hospital. Altogether today, they've seen 362 people. They've had four deaths, one a firefighter apparently had a heart attack, just overcome by all of the destruction. 50 major injuries. You know, the interesting thing that Mayor Giuliani was saying earlier was that he was saying the city doesn't need any more volunteers. Apparently, at this hospital, they had 500 doctors show up, 150 nurses show up, all volunteers from all over the city, all five boroughs, Long Island, up upstate New York, New Jersey. They said they've been overwhelmed with volunteers. But the other thing is, interestingly enough, we've been saying all over the place and actually all over the country, we've been talking about how they need blood. Well, apparently right here at St. Vincent's, they've turned away people. They're saying that they do not need blood. They're in very, very good supply. And one of their major strategies here, they seem to be very, very together. One reason, because they were a main artery for victims during the 1993 bombing at the World Trade Center. So they've been through this before. Most of the injuries then were smoke inhalation, but they've been through this before. They get the people who are have minor injuries, smoke inhalation, those types of injuries. They get them in and out of the emergency room right away, and they send them to other places to check on them, other makeshift emergency rooms throughout the city, so that they can have lots of room in the emergency room for the major injuries. So they say right now they've got about 5 people in the emergency room. They are on standby for all of the officers, all of the firefighters, and all of the other people that we've been talking about all evening who are supposedly alive underneath that debris. And that is exactly what they are waiting to see come up here. Now, I just want to introduce the person who runs the emergency room. It's Dr. Richard Westfal. He has been on top of this the entire time. And doctor, tell me, what is going on right now? We just saw a couple of officers come in, and what is the status really right now?
Right. As you know, we've had at St. Vincent's about 360 patients since about 9 o'clock this morning, of which about 50 of them are really severe traumas, and we've had 4 deaths, and we've admitted many, many patients. And as you mentioned, we have triaged patients out of the emergency department up to other areas. We've taken over a rehabilitation gym. We've taken over a Rice psychiatry gym, and we've taken over a dialysis unit and made them into makeshift small emergency departments so that we're available. And right now we do have about 5 patients in the main emergency department. So we're available for major traumas, for rescuers that are coming in, and for, I would agree with the mayor, is we're all hopeful that some victims will still be rescued and we'll be able to help them to survive. I think that's a hope that we all have.
Now, I was just saying before that you've been through this before because of 1993, so you really know how to handle. Obviously, this is much greater magnitude, but I mean...
I think that's probably the only fortunate thing from 1993, because there we saw about 200 patients, but about 185 of them were smoke inhalations, meaning people that had some difficulty breathing and had smoke on their face, etc. But we're not really that injured or that hurt. I just reviewed an article we participated in from then, and only 10 victims throughout all New York City, only 10 patients died during that disaster, and certainly the numbers obviously are more dramatic than that now.
Now, we are really surprised to hear, because I heard the governor of Pennsylvania talking about go out and give blood. All over the country, they've been talking about giving blood, and you just told me that you all don't need that.
Well, you know what happened was, all since this morning, right on the corner behind me on 11th Street, 7th Avenue, we had a makeshift card table with tables, and we actually took volunteers that went up to the blood bank and donated blood. But as of about 5 or 6 o'clock, they closed that down by asking volunteers if we didn't need it any further.
Okay. You know what? I just want to divert us over again. We see more patients seeming to come over. I can't identify whether or not it's an officer or a civilian, but we see, once again, activity picking up from people coming in off of gurneys from downtown, and it seems like maybe they've started the digging, and, you know, maybe hopefully they are bringing those people up, because as we have heard reports throughout the night that there are a lot of people who were crying, screams, trying to indicate that they were definitely alive under all of the debris, which is absolutely amazing considering all of these hours. But once again, I guess I can say that maybe the only wonderful news out of this, as the president was saying today, we may have had buildings damaged, but the American spirit is certainly not damaged, and they are definitely very well prepared right here at St. Vincent's Hospital. Because of the last tragedy in 1993, because of all of the volunteers that have come out. I mean, I was over at Chelsea Piers just about an hour and a half ago, and there were streams of people, civilians, just coming, just arriving, walking in, volunteering. People just off the street in regular clothes, willing to help out however they could, because they just wanted to be a part of this. Everybody feels, you know, their hearts just go out to all of the victims, whether or not you knew people or not. There's no way not to feel what is going on here. So,
Dari
once
Alexander.
Again, they are very much prepared.
Dari Alexander, we thank you very much for your live reporting as we continue to sort of track the triage effort in New York City. Also, some interesting information just coming in. This on the massive investigation, the Justice Department obviously at the lead of it, the FBI working very hard right now. We have gotten word from senior correspondent Rita Cosby that apparently her intelligence sources are telling her that the intelligence intercepts that they have gotten that may link this to Osama bin Laden or his backers. Apparently, these were cell phone calls. Rita reporting that in one case, they intercepted a call where a bin Laden backer was acknowledging that some of the targets had been hit. Another intercept apparently was from someone who appears to have been a bin Laden backer on a plane who may have been talking to someone else either on another part of the plane or elsewhere. Just a little bit more information. Cell phone intercepts have been helpful in previous incidents in terms of tracing who is behind terrorist attacks. We would just remind you that in August of 1998, U.S. intelligence was able to pin down bin Laden's, Osama bin Laden's ties to the East Africa bombings, those two embassies, U.S. embassies in Kenya and Tanzania, because they were able to intercept cell phone calls. Once again, it appears that cell phone calls may give us a significant break in this investigation in these first hours after the terrorist attacks.
Linda, you know, we're still we still have with us Monsignor Jim Lisante of the Catholic Church. You know, Monsignor, you heard Dari Alexander talking about all the volunteers over at St. Vincent's helping the wounded. Does the faith community have a similar, like, outpouring of volunteers to help what is going to be a huge number of bereaved?
Yeah, I think that folks will step forward. You know, religion can be a great help in that people are encouraged by their particular religion to be generous. I have to tell you, though, that what you're seeing, if it is bin Laden, is a real bastardization of religion, which happens too often in our world, where people use their particular religious point of view to justify their killing. Certainly the statements you've had on Fox earlier tonight from him indicate that he believes that his religion gives him the right. No one who is a theologian who reads the Quran or is a Muslim believes that that idiot knows what he's talking about. But he believes he has the right to kill because of his religion. It's very sad. I need to ask you guys questions. Do you worry about saying on the air that the FBI is moving in on Dade County and maybe giving a leg up on these poor people who can be co-conspirators and hide information?
We would worry, but we assume that they are a step ahead of us.
Okay.
Monsignor, if I could just ask you to hang on for just a moment. I mentioned a moment ago this information that senior correspondent Rita Cosby is just getting from her intelligence sources. We've tracked her down. She's on the phone with us now to explain a little bit more. Rita, what do you know about these cell phone calls that may be linked to Osama bin Laden backers?
Well, and Linda, I want to also tell our viewers I'm on a train right now coming from Stamford, Connecticut to Washington, and in fact, some people who were wounded actually in the attack are on the plane with me here, including some Red Cross workers. A lot of them got on at Penn Station, and some of them got off in Newark. Some of them got off in Trenton, but some of them are still on the plane, train with me here, and some of them covered with ash. These are sort of the so-called walking wounded, the ones who were not seriously injured, but some of them said that they were going home. Some of them were going to go to other hospitals outside of New York, so it's a pretty ominous sight here, even on this train that I'm on. But I've been talking to some law enforcement officials, and they were telling me that my intelligence sources are telling me that they were able to intercept at least two cell phone calls from bin Laden supporters. And they were able to intercept one from a supporter that appears to have been on the ground acknowledging that two of the three or two of the four targets were hit. We know that there were at least four, but the intercept may have said two of the three targets have been hit. In the other case, there was another phone call that was intercepted from appears to be someone who was on the plane, a bin Laden backer, talking about some logistics of the hijacking. So these are two intercepts that were intercepted by U.S. intelligence officials actually overhearing bits of conversations from bin Laden backers. And this is part of the reason that they strongly believe that he is behind this attack. It's also important to note that this has been a resource that intelligence officials have used before, that in August of 1998, U.S. intelligence officials were also able to intercept mobile phone conversations from two bin Laden backers at that point who were discussing the East Africa bombings. Those are the bombings of the U.S. embassies in East Africa, and that's how they were able to pin those two blasts to bin Laden. So this is a practice that they have used before successfully. And this is indeed what we're hearing in addition to some other information that are pointing signs towards bin Laden. In addition to this, they keep telling me that they strongly believe that they've done a lot of research since these attacks were carried out, and that they still strongly believe that he is the only one with the sort of sophistication, the finances, and the widespread infrastructure to be able to carry that out. But now they're getting some hard and fast evidence that seems to be tying him to it.
Rita, it may seem to a lot of people that it would be impossible to have records of or some recording of a cell phone call.